Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to another show. Now, listen, brothers and sisters, we're streaming live all over the entire world. Contrary to what you think, we're not local. If you don't believe me, call us if you're in Spain, Portugal, or Miami. The number is 773-434-6625 or 773-434-6631. Now, this is Chicago. I have to tell you, this is Chicago, and everybody is running for something. But I have a friend of mine.
And a few people are running from something.
Yes. Oh, yes. But she's a friend of mine. You're still a friend?
I'm still a friend.
Okay. The clerk of the circuit court, Miss Dorothy Brown, who kept her own name. How are you?
I'm great.
Thank you. Your nails look lovely.
Oh, thank you.
Have you been?
I'm fantastic.
Now, I just happened to take a visit to City Hall yesterday. And I was at County Building, and there are a lot of activities down there. I didn't see many of the candidates, but I saw campaign managers and things of that nature. Everybody seemed to be scrambling, trying to get rid of this one or that one. How many of you all is left now?
From what I understand, I think there are 15.
15 people trying to get this seat.
But it's a big city, you know.
Is it?
So, yes.
Well, the budgets are, but I guess you're talking about a budget of about $8 billion.
No,
it's about $20 billion.
Well,
when you CHA, CTA.
Well, if you add all those.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. But that's a lot of power. I wonder how Rahm Emanuel feels that it's being revealed that he was in charge of all of this. And I don't remember black people getting an awful lot. Do you think black people are going to get anything this time if one of you all get it? I just have to ask you. I know you don't go and tell me you followed the whole city. I understand.
No, what I'm saying is under my administration.
Is it going to be fair?
It's going to be absolutely fair. And in my comprehensive economic development plan, Mr. Muhammad, I talk about prioritizing the neighborhoods that have been neglected the most because they haven't been prioritized in the past. Yes, I do. And that's the west side and the south side of the city of Chicago.
So you feel that'll be fair if you gave some credence to the west side and the south?
To prioritize to those neighborhoods that have neglected the most, because you got to start to bring them up. They have been left behind for far too long.
So,
you're
going to ignore Watertown Place?
I'm sorry?
Are you going to ignore Watertown
Place? No. I also talk about the fact that we need to ensure that our economic engines continue to run strong. Those are our major economic engines, and we want them to continue to run strong. However, we want to prioritize and start to raise the level of those neighborhoods that have been neglected the most, and to start to use the tax increment financing funds, the TIF funds, in the truly blighted areas.
I want to be clear that I heard that. Uh-huh. You want to use the TIF where?
The TIF funds in the truly blighted areas.
So are you suggesting that hasn't been the case?
I'm not suggesting that that hasn't been the case. I'm saying that that has not been the case.
So there's no ambiguity. You know what you're speaking of.
Absolutely. Okay. Navy Pier is not a blighted area.
So we have Dorothy Brown, who happened to be the clerk of the circuit court. But what makes you want to be mayor out there? You need the headache? I mean, all the scrutiny and,
It's not a headache.
It's not.
Helping people is not a headache. Helping to ensure that there is fairness, that there is equity, that there is justice in the way we do the educational system in this city is not a headache. Helping to ensure the same thing as it relates to economic development is not a headache. And helping to ensure that we have criminal and social justice reform in this city is not a headache. It will be a pleasure for me to serve. It's about service. It's about raising, making this city world class throughout.
Oh, so it's not world class now?
To stop having the haves and the have-nots. And so,
sound like the movies to me. But I have to ask you this, though. Everybody's talking about getting rid of somebody. What about the education? I mean, will you keep this the person in place there? Or will you come in wholesale changes? You don't like the cabinet of Mayor Emanuel? Or will you give them some freedom to maybe exercise their job? Some people say they've been stranglehold.
Well, you know, I'm going
now, this
to
is
give
what some people say.
Everyone an opportunity to reapply, you know, for their positions. And then that way I can then make my assessments. You know, every mayor deserves to have his or her, no, every mayor deserves to have her own cabinet. And so therefore, I will give people an opportunity, but I have to assess whether or not your appointment was just purely political or was it really professional? Are you really qualified to do that particular job? That's the way I did when I took office as clerk of the court, and that's what I'm going to do as mayor of the
because
city of Chicago.
You were revolutionary when you took over the courts.
Absolutely.
That's true.
Yes.
So are you optimistic that you're going to be the one to emerge as the candidate?
You know, I'm very optimistic. We have been working very hard, going out to all the communities. You know, I've been working for 18 years as clerk of the court, and even more as just a regular everyday citizen, you know, helping people and so and doing the kind of things that I feel people understand, the reason why people trust me. They know me. I have a proven track record. I am a proven leader. And so we feel really good about our chances. And we feel good about our chances because we have an outreach throughout the city of Chicago, throughout and through all of the different ethnic groups.
Well, now let me just ask you, just in case people don't know who you are.
Mm-hmm.
What are your qualifications? What make you deem qualified to run for mayor?
Well, let me say
I mean,
this.
Do you have more than a high school education?
I do. And interestingly enough, Manir, I talk about the fact that I'm getting ready to say I have the perfect confluence of background, experience, and the heart to be the mayor of the city of Chicago. The heart is the most important. Because if you don't have a heart to be the mayor, if you don't have a heart that cares about people, then having a background, academic background or experience means nothing. So from the background, from an academic background standpoint, now the city council is a legal lawmaking body, I'm an attorney.
You have a law degree.
I'm an attorney. I do not just have a law degree. When you say you have a law degree, that means you have not passed the bar.
Oh, that is what it means, isn't it?
Yes, you just finished law school.
Yeah.
But
you are
passing the bar.
Passing
the bar is the extra thing that you have to do in order to call yourself an attorney.
Okay.
So I am an attorney. Now, I didn't even run for my first public office before I went back to law school and for 3.5 years and then and became an attorney because I thought that I may be a legislator. And I felt that if you're going to make the law, you should know the law. And see, the city council is a legal lawmaking body.
That's true.
And so it's important to have my law degree, my being an attorney, will help me be able to manage that process.
Right.
And then, of course, you're talking about an $8 billion budget. And we need new revenue ideas. We need someone that can understand the budget process. And I am a CPA. Now, Manir, there are not many people in this country that have passed the Certified Public Accountants exam and the bar exam.
I'm not just
a regular accountant, yes.
Yeah.
There are not many people in this country.
You have some juice. You have the doctorate of accountant.
Okay, yes.
Okay.
There are not many people in this country that have passed both of those examinations.
So this is not just the year of the woman. You're telling me this is no token. You're qualified
to
do that.
It's the year of the qualified woman. Yes.
Okay.
And then I have an MBA in finance.
But wow, that's a triple crown.
That $8 billion. And then, of course, I have I minored in technology.
Is that right?
Yeah.
So I noticed you normally have iPads and all that. So you pretty.
I minored in technology, so I can make sure that we run from an operational efficiency standpoint in the technology arena. Cost efficiency.
The reason I wanted to.
That's why I said
that.
Perfect confluence.
That's why I have to ask you. Because you came in making changes with technology as a clerk, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And you did things that you said you would do, and you went beyond. And that was kind of antiquated your predecessor, who absolutely was so foreign till they made her a judge. I mean,
yes.
No, but I mean, there was a lot of conversation about your predecessor.
Mm, wow.
And said she was politically connected, and she really didn't run the office in the modern time. Mm-hmm. I want people to remember that.
Yes, yes, yes.
So you did modernize.
Yes, I did, and we continue to do so. As a matter of fact, I'm in the process of putting in a brand new case management system.
So even though you're becoming mayor, you're not going to leave.
I'm solidifying, yes.
Yeah, you're still working.
Yes. You are.
Mm-hmm. Okay, some people say you're doing such a great job. What made you jump over to the mayor, and you're saying, because it was
that is
bigger,
why I'm going for the mayor.
Because you qualified and everybody else just been playing games.
And yes, and when you do a good job in an arena, you should take those talents and then improve another arena. Not just simply continue to mark time at this particular area. We should be looking for someone that's a proven leader to then take over a huge, you know, a larger operation and make that run smoother. I have a $100 million budget. Now, a lot of people look at my title as clerk, and they think I'm just a secretary or just keep a few records. She's a clerk, clerk of the court. Okay. No, I am the CEO of a $100 million organization. And I have been doing that successfully for the last 18 years, you know, having my own information systems department, human resources, payroll, finance, 17 different locations throughout Cook County, 1,400 employees, managing that process as a CEO of a multi-million-dollar organization.
How many people work for you?
1,400. I used to have 2,200. As you can see, the budget has been cut over the years. But in spite of the cutting of the budget, we have been able to make sure that we continue to operate at a professional level.
Well, some people seem to think that you are a threat, and they want you gone. Did you know that? I mean, this is, you know, you hear these things.
Is that right?
Yeah. That you're so overqualified, they don't want you to get a chance to debate another. Did you hear that?
No, I have not heard
okay,
all of that.
Let's go to the phone and see if anybody else heard it. Caller, you on the air.
Hi, Assalamu alaikum, Brother Munir. This is Sister Noor Muhammad calling from Camden, New Jersey.
How are you?
I'm doing well, and good evening to Ms. Brown. It's wonderful to see you back on the program. And Brother Munir, you probably asked all of the questions that I had, so I'll just make a comment. And I appreciate you, Ms. Brown. I appreciate that you're talking about your qualifications, not as a woman who's qualified, but as a person who's qualified. I think all three are enchanted by setting trends, you know, to be the first woman and to be the woman in a position, but you're wanting to be the person in the position. And I wish you all the best, and I wish that I could cast my vote from Camden, New Jersey, but I certainly encourage voters there to put your name down on the ballot as their choice. And get you in there so that you can do the job that needs to be done.
Thank you. Thank you. Absolutely.
So you don't think she was just biased because she's a woman?
Absolutely not. Sounds like she listened
sounds like
to
she
our.
Could see.
Yeah, she listened to our conversation. She listened to my credentials, and she recognized that I am a qualified individual to for the city of Chicago and really to bring change. You know. Fannie Lou Hamer said, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people are sick and tired of being sick and tired, just sitting back and just accepting the same old, business as usual, you know, new person getting elected, school systems continue to go down, having a $500 million contract let out for cleaning the schools, but yet find that the schools were dirty.
Oh, that seems like that person won't be here no more if you have anything to do.
You know, and finding that we're permitting our children to be sexually assaulted without properly reporting that to the criminal authorities, and all of those kind of things. And the biggest travesty is the miseducation of our children, the low level of curriculum, that the fact that you have to go to a magnet school or higher to get a decent education in the city.
That doesn't bode well for the education.
Does not bode well at all. I feel that every school that a child goes to should be at a magnet school level.
You meant taking another call?
Fine.
No, evidently. Well, look, if you want to talk to Dorothy Brown, 773-434-6625 or 6631. And you took a swipe at the education. What about the crime and statistics?
Well, you know, the criminal justice system is just, a travesty as well. I think that the education system, the lack of economic development, equals the crime that has occurred in our system, our city, because the children, people have graduated and don't have the tools to get good jobs. 70% of the graduates on last year didn't even qualify to go directly into city colleges. They would have had to take remedial classes.
Is that right?
Yes, 70%. The graduation rate up, but the number of qualified individuals
But, you
down.
Know, I had the chief of education, and they told me that they were in the top 10 in the country.
Top 10 of what? Number of graduates, yes.
Yeah, graduates, and they had improved greatly.
Improved based upon what?
Reading, their reading scores. And
yeah, but where did they come up from?
Oh,
so what are they comparing it to?
Well, obviously you know something that I don't know. They painted such a good picture, and they even told me the criminal assaults that you're talking about had been investigated thoroughly. And that was something that had happened years ago, and a few of them sneaked through the cracks.
Oh, well, that's not from what we could see, because why did they then create a different kind of reporting system?
Yeah.
You know, and then also, if they knew about those, why didn't they do the background checks? Why did they all of a sudden do background checks for 100% of the people during the summer of 2018?
Yeah, because they're still doing them right now.
Yeah, so if they already knew about it, then why didn't they put those things in place prior to the Tribune bringing that information out?
Oh, okay.
If they did know about it and they didn't do that, then that's
even worse.
That's worse, yes.
Okay, well, let's take another call. A caller, you're on the air.
I do background checks. 100% of the people during the summer of
2018. Now, hello, are you there,
Carla? I already knew about it, then why didn't they put those things in place?
Yes.
Yeah, because you can't listen to your...
Hello?
You're listening to your TV.
If they didn't know about it, they didn't.
Hello? You're listening to your TV.
Yes, I just want to ask the question is, if she can make a way where the brothers can secure...
Can you turn your television
down? Turn your television down, please. I just stepped out of the room. Hello?
There you go.
Oh.
Yeah, we're here.
Yeah, I just want to ask a question, Shaku, that is it a way for her to hire the brothers in the neighborhood to secure their own?
Hire the brothers
in the violence?
She talking about that CURE program. Uh-huh. You know, getting... like your safe passage, getting the community to secure itself. Yakub, you didn't call me daddy, did you, boy? Man, you called me daddy. No, they're not going to secure you. You might not check out criminally. You're not a policeman, are you?
No, sir.
You know, what we want to do, though, I think what he's talking about is, you know, creating some vocational training to help the brothers in the neighborhood, if you will, to help people that are already out of school, then that's through economic development. My economic development plan is creating
reentry.
jobs. Yeah. Also, in my urban policy plan, where I focus on the West Side and the South Side, those communities that have been neglected the most, I do talk about reentry programs and helping people, the returning citizens, if you will, to get a vocational training, to be able to get the things that are necessary, the wraparound services that are necessary to help them to not recidivate.
Now, let me ask you this. The media, certain TV stations, have been adamant about scrutinizing you. Has that subsided? You know, always bothering you?
It's interesting they had, it was interesting that in December when the FBI went to Alderman Ed Burke's office and papered over his windows and raided both his offices, his ward office and downtown office, I didn't see that they did as much scrutinizing, and you didn't see every time that, and I didn't look that closely, but every time they mentioned his name, they'll say he's under federal investigation, and which is clear that he was under federal investigation. And
so you said the language was different with you.
Let me say this. That kind of thing never happened to me, they took my cell phone and gave it back. They didn't find anything on there incriminating. And so, but yet I have to have, every time you mention my name, an elusive, so-called federal investigation that, people that were out to get me decided to go and lie about, so enough is enough. It's time to just put that stuff to rest, because what happened with Ed Burke is clearly then less than a month later, they then wind up actually arresting and indicting him.
And even though they had been investigating him, wiretapping him for 18 months.
And it's interesting. And so it doesn't take a long time for people to figure those kind of things out.
But no one has given you an apology yet, though.
Well, I doubt very seriously I'll ever get an apology or an announcement of any sort, which is fine. That's why I'm running for mayor, because I have the background to do this, and I can't let, this is probably running for this office is the reason why those individuals were trying to taint my reputation. But it has not worked. People trust me. People know me. And they know me because I've been out here for 18 years respecting all the communities, doing things in the community. And so, but let me say this, Mr. Muhammad. One of the things with the Ed Burke indictment, it speaks to, for me, my economic development plan, which says that we need to get away from the ward-level approach for economic development. In other words, having the alderman to make the decision on economic development in their ward. Just because you're elected alderman does not make you an economic development expert. I have proposed and am proposing that we have eight planning districts. We'll break up this city into eight planning districts. The planning districts will be downtown, South Side, South Central, and West, Southwest, North Side, North Central, and Northwest, and then the West Side. And with these planning districts, you have a combination of wards, because a lot of times wards are so close, they overlap almost. You can live on one side of the street and be in one ward, another side of the street and be in another ward. So if you're going to do an economic development plan, it needs to incorporate more than just a ward. It needs to be the entire planning district. And what we would do is, what I would do is have economic development teams for each of the districts, and they would then propose a skeletal economic development plan. And with that skeletal economic development plan, I would then have the community, all the stakeholders, the elected officials, the faith base, the not-for-profits, the just community residents in general, the millennials, the youth, the schools, the park districts, the health institutions, all those different stakeholders within the community would then have input into the economic development plan. The business owners.
Yes, ma'am. Brothers and sisters, we're talking to Dorothy Brown, the clerk of the circuit court. She's running for mayor. She has an economic plan for the entire city, right? So who are some of your advisors? Do you have some advisors on your team helping you to form this ambitious policy that you...
I do.
You so rather keep them
yes.
secret?
Yes.
Well, it's no secret that you beat the Democratic Party, which is such a rarity. So some people are saying you have an organization within itself that is quite capable of surprising.
You know, the people, my organization consists of common everyday people.
Common
everyday people.
Okay.
Grassroots organization of people that just simply have said enough is enough, and that they believe in me, they believe in my abilities, and they know that I have the desire and the heart because of the things that I've done in the past. Well, you know, especially, you know, you want to look at the things that I have reached beyond the four walls of the clerk of the court. I've come on here and talked about the expungement summit, where I have been able to give people a second chance to get their lives in order.
They tell me it's a new law. You had something to do with that, or did you?
Well, with the new law, and I put proposed several different laws down there related to, in Springfield, related to the expungement summit, related to expungements. And the latest law, and I won't take credit for it. I support it, but I will not take credit for it, for the one. But at the same time, I had another that was going forth that I had proposed, that was also passed. But this latest one says that there are only four areas of law that if you have a felony conviction within, you cannot request, or you don't qualify. You do not qualify for an expungement. And that those four areas are sexual assault, animal crime, domestic violence, and DUI. Those four. Other than that, felony convictions, you can qualify for a sealing of your criminal record, which is just as good as an expungement, because you can say on a job application that I've never been arrested, I've never been charged of a crime. When you get a sealing of those things, you can do that for any other criminal conviction, or if it wasn't a conviction. If it wasn't a conviction, of course, you just simply qualify to get it expunged, which is to obliterate it all the way from your files.
Okay, are you thinking of reducing the city council? Some people are talking about there are too many representatives for the 50 ward.
Yeah, no, I'm not thinking about reducing city council. We have almost 3 million people in this city, and it's a large city. It's a huge land base, and we probably need those individuals to help me manage that process. But I'm going to, like I said, get rid of the ward level approach to economic development, get rid of the fact that you have to get approval from your alderman. When Alderman Burke said that, you know, had those individuals with that Burger King trying to get approval for
I think it was alleged.
When they were trying to get approved. Yeah, well, it's alleged based upon those telephone conversations.
Well, according to them, they charged with attempted.
Yeah, they did charge him with
reason
why they said attempted is because the people didn't pay up.
Well.
But anyway, they didn't pay up. They didn't do what he wanted him to do. They didn't give him
his business.
Did they ever
mention money?
But they did do that donation to Tony Preckwinkle. Now, they did give a $10,000 donation to Tony Preckwinkle, which goes to what a lot of them have been doing.
If they thought that was the case, they would have charged him with extortion.
You know.
Totally.
No, what I'm saying is they did do that. They gave the donation, supposedly it was given back and that sort of thing, but they felt constrained constrained to do that.
Have you read the indictment?
I read all 37 pages.
Okay. Our brothers and sisters, we're talking to Dorothy Brown, who's obviously showing her
legal
skills.
And he uses City Hall secretary to make some of those calls, or to use his personal email address to contact the firm about getting his law business.
They charged him with one count.
From what I understand, it was one count. Yes.
Yeah, the U.S. attorney normally sends me that kind of stuff. Perhaps I
you didn't
I get
read
it from
the indictment yet. Yeah,
no, I haven't read the indictment.
That's online.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you for enlightening me. Our brothers and sisters, 773-434-6625 or 434-6631. Let me ask you this before we go. But why the in the 37 pages for one charge?
Well, it all surrounded. It occurred over, you know, a period of time. When they first started doing the renovation, and he drove by there, and he saw that it. Well, he rode by there, and he saw that the renovations were going on, and he called his ward office employee and said, "Renovations are going on there. Do they have their permits? Do they have their permits, rehab permits, and do they have their driveway permit?" I guess they found out they had the rehab permit, so then he said, "Do they have the driveway permits?" And then he told them to set up a meeting with him and them to talk about, to talk. And then he took them to the Beverly Country Club.
Did they have the surveillance?
They did have, yeah, they did. They had a wiretap on him.
I know they had wiretap, mm-hmm. but I mean, did they have under surveillance?
They did.
As he drove
well, I don't know if they had him under surveillance because the reason why, well, they did the individuals let them know that they went to the Beverly Country Club for this.
I'm not a lawyer, but I do know that Alderman Berg probably haven't driven in 20 years. You know, so mm-hmm. you know, driving by, and they could have been taking pictures of somebody else.
Well, I'm not to say.
You're not debating
I'm not
that.
Saying that they.
But you get back your
I'm
donation.
I'm saying it had
that Tony Prentwinkle.
Yes, accept it. Yes.
But where did this $100,000 come in?
What $100,000? Oh, it was $10,000.
Oh, maybe somebody
it
else.
It was $10,000. Oh my goodness, we have something else going on here. Oh, it's $116,000. So the fundraiser that Ed Burke held as his home. On behalf of Tony Prentwinkle in January 2018, that he was requesting the donation for another public official from the individuals from Burger King, they raised $116,000 at that fundraiser
for her reelection.
For her reelection as county board.
Had nothing to do with mayor.
No, it did not.
Okay.
So, but however, and he gave her $13,000. So she had already given that back when the windows got. You know, paste it over, paper it over, and then I call for her to give that whole $116,000 back because, you know, much of that money, you know, and they looked at her finance. I even said they need to look at every business in the fourth ward that is given to see whether or not they, and talk to them to see if they were given under duress because a lot of people feel like they have to give. Some of these folks kind of allude to them.
That that's not the case.
You don't have, right, absolutely.
Because they tried to lean on you,
exactly.
And you got your money back.
You didn't.
Carly, you're on the air. Carly, so as the Democratic candidate, you defied and you were glad that they did kick you off. We got to talk about that. Carly, you're on the air.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
And good evening, Madam Clerk.
Good evening.
I want to direct my question as it relates to working class people, retirees in this city, and who feel the pinch of rising costs everywhere, no matter where you turn. And I think even in this new budget, or it was in the last budget, that even property taxes are still going to go up in Chicago, even though we had a property tax increase. So, you know, you said that you are an accountant. Mm-hmm. Do you have any ideas on how you are going to contain some of these costs? Because people are leaving not only Chicago, they leave in the south suburbs, they are leaving Illinois. And I do think we need to work on trying to make sure we keep our people here.
Okay, we'll hold that question.
Oh,
remember that.
We need to take
Let
a break.
Let me take it now. We're going to take another call.
Oh.
And so you're sharp enough. You're an accountant. You got a great memory. What's the caller? You're on the air.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam. You have a question or a comment?
This is your son calling from Georgia. Good evening to you, Ms. Dorothy Brown.
Good evening.
I just have one question about the expungement. Does it matter a length of time you have to wait before you can get your record expunged?
Okay, so, and of course, I'm talking about things that occurred in the state of Illinois, and there are different rules, especially as it relates to expungement and the waiting periods. It can be anywhere from 3 to 5 year waiting periods for certain things. Now, for the one that I was talking about with the criminal convictions where you can qualify for a sealing for everything but the four that I named, it's 3 or more years after your final sentence. It has a probation. Mm-hmm. It includes after probation. Everything has to be terminated. Satisfactory.
Okay. Was that a crime? There was not a gun involved, was it?
No.
Okay. Now, was it drugs?
Doesn't matter.
Yes, sir. Drugs. It doesn't
those four things that I said.
As long as you didn't kill a dog.
Guns not.
Yeah. Okay. And I'm going to answer.
And drugs are not there either.
Question that they call them.
Okay, cause containment, and how do we help people to not leave this city? And so what I have been talking about, and what was the young lady's name?
Kim,
what I've been talking about, and it's all a part of my economic development plan, and is I'm talking about community health and wealth building. See, property taxes, there are two elements to property taxes, the equalized assessed valuation and the tax rate. The tax rate is applied to the equalized assessed valuation. Right. In other words, the value of the property. The problem is, because we have permitted some of our neighborhoods to go into despair for so long, those properties are not on the tax rolls. Or if they're on the tax rolls, nobody's paying them, right? So what I want to do is to revive our communities, give our people an opportunity to come back to our neighborhoods, purchase our homes, give some first-time home buyer grants, not loans, but grants. Maybe even use the homeless to help rehab. So that gives them some money. So our neighborhoods start, my plan is a community health and wealth building. So our neighborhoods start to revive and thrive. I want to help people that want to start a small business or have a small business to actually be able to survive. Now you start to put those things back on the tax roll, and then the tax rate on all of the rest of us does not have to.
Now, I know you and Tony Preckwinkle don't sit down and have lunch, but it sounds like she has a program like that with Rob Rose.
Well, I'm sorry. You're talking about the land bank or something?
Yeah, the land bank.
Community land bank? What about the community land bank?
Don't they help?
If that's the case, what's happening to our neighborhoods?
Well, I thought
Why are they in the shape they're in? They obviously are not doing
enough.
Right?
So why don't you and she combine to work together?
Because it's actually, I believe it's in Chicago and
workforce
development. Yes, I can bring all of that together, yes.
Okay, very good. We had another caller, but they couldn't stand to be patient. We're streaming live, brothers and sisters. I'd like to talk to Dorothy Brown. She's a really, really knowledgeable person. And so you need to call her. And maybe, what about some of those, we have a caller. Mm-hmm. Caller, you're on the air with Dorothy Brown.
I'm on the air now?
You are.
This is Brother David. I'm down here in Birmingham, Alabama.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
On vacation. And this message is from the hood to all black politicians. Don't never touch not nail dime that don't belong to you. Don't never accept no gifts, because that's how they going to come at you with that indictment. And when you get an indictment, you might as well take that first plea bargain, because if you try to fight it, you're going to really get it.
So
that message is from the hood.
Have you ever been in the federal federally indicted? You're a politician.
No, sir. I'm straight out the hood. Look here. Okay. On an indictment, it clearly states, right, that the United States of America versus whoever it is.
Okay.
You can't win. The conviction rate is 9.99.
Okay, well, we're going to take a break.
AKA 100.
All right, we're going to take a break and see if we find another lawyer. Hey, but you know what? I met a lawyer. Thank you, Carla. Enjoy Birmingham. I left there running. But let me tell you, do you remember? It's a sister. She's in the public defender's office. Her name is Tiara.
Okay.
She's a rock star. I mean, well, not a rock star, but she's a star. She don't lose many cases.
Oh, wow. Great.
I mean, these are murder cases.
Really?
She fight for her,
wow,
her
for
constituency. Now, mm-hmm, they tell me she's pretty good.
Oh, great.
You know, maybe you should have her as your corporation counsel.
Oh, you're picking my corporation counsel?
Yeah, just in case. I'm calling you on the air. That's how Hal Washington picked Jim Montgomery. Are you there, caller?
Yes. Is Brother Moon in?
It is.
Yes, yeah, sir. Slumber Lake.
Who is this?
This is Brother James Ramey.
Who?
James Ramey. That's my first name.
Okay, James.
Yeah, my, I wanted to talk about the dollar, not the dollar side, but the free $1 for your land. And they have here in Chicago that you pay $1 and you can get a lot.
Oh, well, maybe the clerk can tell you about that.
What does he want to talk about?
What do you want to say about that?
Well, I wanted to say on how a bunch of us over here in Grand Crossing, we got the lot for $1, but then they never generated a bill, and then they wind up selling our lot and telling us 2 years later that it had been sold, but they never generated a bill. And if I go online, it's not there. So I wanted to ask about that because it seems like it's a scam with this dollar lot. It's about...
You have to make sure... I know a little something about that, but I'll allow Dorothy to...
So they didn't... They didn't.
No, it's like redeeming...
Give him the bill so he can pay his dollar.
Yeah, you redeem the property, but you have to verify that it's been redeemed. I think for a two-year waiting period, you have to send a letter to the previous owner to make sure they had a chance to redeem it.
The city should not sell properties for $1 that they haven't already validated the title.
Well, you know that. I think
because if they're coming in, the citizen doesn't have time.
Maybe, hey, I am the deputy treasurer, you know, honorary. Maybe I'll call Maria Pappas and get her involved. I'm not joking. Next time you call, I have an answer for you.
Okay. Yes, sir. Because you know they're saying we owe money, and
call me off the air and give me your information tomorrow. Okay.
But that's a program that we need to improve. Okay.
Yeah.
We need to look at.
Well, that's why I got
a lot of those things supposed to be beneficial to the community, but they're not.
But Maria, you've noted the tax property that they were taking from people who didn't pay their taxes.
Well, no, he's talking about that.
No, but he's talking about if I own a piece of property and someone had their home demolished next to me and it becomes a vacant lot. So there's still a lien on the property. So the city can make it available for taxes, right? But I don't know about $1. That seems pretty cheap there.
Yeah, they have some properties out there.
But we'll get Maria in here and see if she helps us.
Okay.
You're on a face down basis with her, aren't you?
I am.
Okay. All right. So we're talking to, are you going to be the next mayor?
I am going to be the next mayor of the city of Chicago.
Well, give us a statement proving that to us. I want you to look into the camera and say, this is the part of the Munir show when I was on my way home. And I said, if he'd only gave me a chance, this is what I would have said. So now I'm giving you a chance. What would you have said?
So I'm saying to the citizens of Chicago that enough is enough. It's time for change. You know, John F. Kennedy said, a rising tide lifts all boats. But that's not happening in the city of Chicago, where our educational system is concerned, where economic development is concerned, and where criminal justice is concerned. I have the perfect confluence of background, experience, and the heart to be the mayor of the city of Chicago. I'm an attorney, and I can handle the legal lawmaking body of the city council. I'm a CPA and MBA, and I can handle the $8 billion budget of the city of Chicago, having already been the CEO of an organization of over $100 million for the last 18 years as clerk of the Circuit Court of Cook County, the second largest court system in the world. Now, I say that I have the background, experience, and the heart to be the mayor. Now, from an experience standpoint, as I said, I've been clerk of the court, but I also have been the general auditor for the Chicago Transit Authority, making sure that those billions of dollars in assets and revenue were properly controlled. And I had a lot of multi-billion dollar clients as an outside auditor. I have the heart because I came from a set of poor and uneducated parents who taught me the value of hard work and dedication. My mother being a cook and a domestic worker, which means that she took care of someone else's children and cleaned up their homes while her 8 children took care of themselves. And my father was a laundry worker and a cotton farmer and took me and my 7 siblings to those cotton fields. So I respect the least to the greatest. I need you to help me bring the fight that I have brought to this office of clerk of the circuit court, to this community for all of these years. I need you to help me bring that fight so I can give hope back to all of the citizens of Chicago. Vote for Dorothy Brown. Go to my website, dorothyformayor.com. Sign up to volunteer. Donate to my campaign, dorothyformayor.com, so you and I can be in partnership to bring true change to the city of Chicago.
Now, let me ask you, all of these 1,400 employees that you have now, and they've done such a good job with you, do you plan to take a contingent of these people with you to the mayor's office?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah?
Absolutely, yes. Yeah.
How many you got in mind?
I don't know. I have no idea.
Are their jobs secure?
Are their jobs secure?
Yeah, I mean, you know, you're not.
I absolutely know that I have some very talented people as a clerk of the court and would love to have them be a part of my administration as mayor of the city of Chicago.
Now, is there going to be a debate? And some people say there are 4 black women struggling for this position. There's no compromise in any of you all to consolidate and let one. Are you asking the 3 of them to retire and let you?
I am running against everybody.
Everybody.
That's in this
race. So you have made no friends. Which is not the day of the sisterhood.
I am running against everybody that's in this race.
Yeah, just like that. but let me just, I put it to you like this. Are you and the president, have you all had lunch since the last time y'all ran against each other?
No.
You know, someone has Dennis Rodman.
You know, we might have been in the at the same luncheon.
But you all know. I mean,
but we
you,
have not had.
But you,
lunch.
I thought you all.
You said since the last time we ran against each other.
Well, yeah.
When we ran against each other in 2010, I take that back. Since she's been county board president, I have been at a luncheon with her. Yes.
Because after all, she controls your budget, doesn't she?
Right yes, now. The county board controls my budget.
But that's
absolutely.
What I'm saying. Don't you have to go in periodically and meet with her? And you say,
we well, do Tony, have meetings, yes.
Well, Tony, what's this?
We I have mean, meetings where they tell us what our budget targets are and the budget deficit that's getting ready to occur and that sort of thing, yes.
But you all don't hang out together.
We don't hang out, no.
Yeah. Okay.
We do not hang out together.
All right, brothers and sisters, as I say, if you want to talk to Clerk Brown, you still have a few minutes. Ms. Brown, you have a stellar career. Everybody knows that. And as you say, you're an auditor for the CTA. You know all of this money is the CTA has an enormous budget.
Yes.
And they have an enormous capital program.
Absolutely.
So
all those buses
jobs.
And the trains and
are
all
you
that.
Satisfied with the minimum amount of involvement that black people have? Everybody want the black vote, but don't seem to be able to get any hand up, you know?
Yeah, people, you
especially
know, people,
these
and people just want a hand up. They don't want a handout, you know, and
even
and
the park district.
No, I'm not satisfied, especially with the transportation in this city and the fact that in a lot of our areas, the buses and do not run, you know, 24 hours.
I thought would you get new
buses? It needs
buses?
To be comparable, you know, throughout the city of Chicago. So we want to take a look at that and make sure that people that are working late at night, that they are not in danger by having to walk too far because bus service has stopped on their particular line. And so it has to be fairness. I talked about fairness and things being fair and equitable and just. We're talking about educational justice, economic justice, and criminal justice.
Yeah. Well, Dorothy Brown, I have to tell you, you don't run from anybody, and we're glad you came tonight. But I'd like to make sure that we're getting the information, because I understand now, not because I'm smart, but because I'm informed, that you may be having a press conference.
Yes, and, I am. I'm having a press conference in the morning at 10:30 at 609 West Washington and the lower level. That's down on the level where the subway is, to talk about what's happening with the petition challenge and the fraudulent things that are going on with my petition challenges. So,
are you suggesting come that the FBI there. Meet you there?
I'm suggesting that, no, I'm not suggesting that the FBI meet me there. It's a county matter.
But that doesn't mean, but the fraudulent vote fraud.
Well, I'm suggesting that I will be discussing what's going on with my petition.
Are you
going to
be there
tomorrow.
By yourself?
I want you there. That's all of my supporters. We are welcome to come. That's 69 West Washington in the lower level, near that subway.
But could we be looking at voter fraud of some kind?
I won't say voter fraud. I'm talking about petition challenges.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now you have, it's about 15 of you all left, right?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So now you are number 3 in fundraising?
Oh, I'm not number 3 in fundraising. You know, I need, that's why I said DorothyForMayor.com. I have a $19 for a 2019 win. And so you can donate $19 so I can win in 2019. Oh. $19 for a 2019 win.
So as minimum is 19.
DorothyForMayor.com. If you don't have $19, you can donate less than that.
Can you do this anonymously?
DorothyForMayor.com. You can go to my website. You can mail the check in. P.O. Box 17405, Chicago, Illinois 60617. You cannot be anonymous. It needs to be reported to the Board of Elections.
I know, but I mean, a person can send you cashier's check and money orders, right?
Oh, you can do cashier's checks, money orders, credit card. We take all of those things. Yeah. And we even take cash, as long as we have the proper identifying information.
Okay, now, you know, a lot of people, you know, Jesse White set the bar so high, he wouldn't allow his employees to donate. Do you prevent your employees from donating?
You know, I don't prevent. You know, I have that policy, but I don't review. I don't review it. I have that policy.
You don't solicit.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Okay. So, brothers and sisters, if you don't like all the questions that I ask, you should ask some yourself. And the way you do that, go on Facebook right now, and I'll make sure Dorothy Brown gets it. We're live right now on YouTube. You can email us at crow@crow.org. Or you have 2 minutes. You can call us, 773-434-6625 or 434-6631. Now, do you anticipate a runoff? Or you think you're going to win this thing straight out?
I would love to win it straight out. If you all go and vote and give me more than 50%, 50 plus, give me 50 plus 1% of the vote, then we can be mayor on February 26th. That just depends on the voters. And so you know my record. You know I'm a proven leader, and I would love to do that. Or I'd be fine to be the top vote getter and go into the runoff and become mayor on April 2nd so that we can move on and bring true change to the city of Chicago.
Now, what do you say about Paul Vallis saying that he managed the school board and, you know...
Was Paul Vallis fired from that job?
Well, he said, his personality became so strong.
So he was fired from that job, and he was fired from the Philadelphia job and fired from the New Orleans job. And so, so I'm not saying that doesn't bode very well.
So they fired him all three.
So that doesn't bode very well to me for someone to run to be the mayor of the city of Chicago. You're running around, you know.
What about Gary Chico?
Just looking for a job.
You know, he just said that he passed. He was the chairman.
He was the chairman. He was a legislator. The mayor of the city of Chicago has to be an administrator and a legislator.
All that.
Yes, okay. Not just the chairman of something, but what did you really run, Gary?
It sounds like you got a little hip talk there, Clay Brown. Okay, well, so we can rest assured you'll be in that number.
I have probably just as many, if not more, employees than Toni Pertwinkle, and she's the county board president. She just chairs the county board. That's the kind of thing I'm talking about.
So, because she really doesn't
have any manager. We manage our operations.
Oh, your own operation.
Yes.
Okay. So you don't use that title president. You call her Toni, huh? So y'all seem like you're on a first name basis. Okay, there you have it. Dorothy Brown, brothers and sisters, she's been here for 18 years. She beat the machine, and she wants you to know she's going to beat it again. Okay, I'm Munir Muhammad on behalf of Crow TV. Thank you so much for watching, and may Allah bless you with the light of understanding as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum.